Hey everybody, this is Shock. Thanks for tuning into the show. And before we begin, good idea to have a pen ready. We're going to go through a lot of information. This will be a 30-minute long show approximately, probably around 25 to 30 minutes. And let me give you a list of websites. As you know, I like to give you guys some free stuff. First of all, if you would like a free website or chat room, go to www.shockonnow.net. That's spelled www.shockawenow.net. I see about over 50 of you have already set up your own video chat conferencing room and your free website. Now, if you would like to subscribe to my videos, go to www.shockforever.com. That's also free. And if you would like some free software, games, etc., go to www.shockonnow.net. You can see this at the shockforever.com page and also my blog talk page. Now, I wanted to talk to you about a wonderful website called creation.com. And what we're going to do is we're going to talk about 15 questions for evolutionists that really have the evolutionists dazed, stumped, and confused. So let me quote Richard Dawkins, first of all. He's one of the main proponents of this fictional evolution theory. This is what Richard Dawkins said. He said, "Our sole purpose is to propagate DNA. At bottom, there is no design, no purpose to life, no evil and no good, nothing but blind, pitiless indifference." Now, you might think that's a little bit to the extreme, but I was recently invited to debate an atheist on a radio show right here on Blog Talk Radio. Look up TCP Radio, Ben Umnas, the Christian Perspective radio show. And I defeated the atheist in that radio show. But during the debate, I asked him, "Do you agree with that, what Richard Dawkins said, that there's no purpose to life, that there's no such thing as good and evil?" And the atheist said, "Yes, I do." That's exactly how he said it. So let's talk about some problems of evolution. You know what I have found is most folks don't know the difference between macroevolution and microevolution. And I think, especially where I live in America and wherever you guys live around the world, I think this is a very important topic, this fictional theory of evolution. And I think it's about time that we drove a wooden stake through the heart of evolution and really expose it for the myth and fraud that it is. Now, the good news is that atheism and evolutionism are being absolutely crushed, where it is actively being confronted. But in societies where it is not being seriously confronted, we're all too often seeing their societies unravel and begin to crumble. So it's like a mixed bag. There's good news and bad news. For example, in the atheistic communist state of China, the good news is Christianity is growing. It is exploding in China, also Africa, by the way. And it can happen in America, in Europe also, and you can help make it happen. Check out creation.com. At the middle of the page there, there'll be a place where you can put in your email address. Please go ahead and put your email address in there, and we'll keep you up to date on how this worldwide grassroots movement to expose the lies, frauds of evolution is going. Now, another thing, guys, is look, if we want to restore a Bible-believing America and re-Christianize Europe and the rest of the world, then us Christians, we need to take action at this time. Christians in the West are literally at a crossroads. And if we don't do something, I believe that we are in store for a world of hurt. You can see it in the news already. Look, the writing is on the wall. And in America and Europe, they're now going from one serious problem to the next. Just check out your local news. Today's news, for example, is filled with rioting, and we have more bad news now more than ever. But at the same time, as I mentioned, it's a mixed bag. There are also people who are looking for answers. And as Christians, we have the answers. They're found in the Bible. So let's talk about the truth of creation and some of the lies and errors of evolution. First of all, if you're 18 years old or older, you were probably taught about a chemical origin of life. Most people were taught that in the primordial soup, through lightning strikes and chemical reactions, that life was birthed and formed, and that was known as the origin of life. They actually used to teach this in schools as fact. But what the layman doesn't know, ladies and gentlemen, is that all those old, outdated, now proven untrue, chemical origin of life scenarios have now broken down and are now rejected by the scientific community, yet they used to teach it as fact in schools. Now, the origin of life on Earth, you could actually say honestly, it is literally, scientifically, inexplicable. Science has no idea. They do not claim to know how the origin of life happened. So right now in the year 2011, as it now stands, scientifically, it is inexplicable. Science has not come up with a conclusion on how life did originate. Now, as Christians, we know how it originated. But what I'm talking about is the evolutionist, the secular scientist. They will not say that God is the creator. Listen to this. Do you guys know who Francis Crick is? If you guys are into science and studying DNA, immediately you'll say, oh yeah, he was the co-discoverer of DNA. Listen what Francis Crick said. Remember, he's the co-discoverer of DNA. He said that the origin of life on Earth, and I quote him, is almost a miracle. In fact, Crick was driven to this hypothesis. His hypothesis is that the origin of life was so improbable that he says it was probably seeded from some other planet elsewhere in the universe, and maybe it came here on meteorites, which I know, of course, is an unfalsifiable hypothesis. As science gains more knowledge, we're moving away from the outdated fictional Darwinian theory of evolution. You will, mark my word, you will see it changing. It's not going to stay the same. You really should pick up also Philip Johnson's book, Darwin on Trial. Now, I don't get anything for telling you about it, but it's a great book because he says some quotes in there that are really cutting evolution off at the knees. Listen what he says. He talks about in his book, Darwin on Trial, it's Philip Johnson, he says that there is a grand theory of Darwinian evolution. And listen close, ladies and gentlemen. He says that it is not something that can simply be read off evidence. Did you hear what he says? He says this grand theory of Darwinian evolution, it doesn't have evidence for it. He says, but rather it is predicated on a philosophical commitment to naturalism. Did you get that? It's a philosophical commitment to naturalism. So let's really be brutally honest and let's look at what the evidence supports. If you are a true free thinker, I used to be an atheist, I'm a Christian, now I realize atheism was wrong. It had no proof and evidence to substantiate its claims. And now I realize, as you look at the errors, lies, and even downright frauds of evolution, there's some serious problems with evolution. What does the evidence support? Well, let's start off with this. What I would advise everyone to do is look at microevolution and look at macroevolution. What the evidence supports is microevolution, which all that is God's creation. That is change within certain limits, how we have different types of horses. But they're all horses, different types of cats, they're all cats, different types of dogs, etc., they're all dogs. Change within certain limits. But everyone agrees with that. Even scripturally, the most fundamentalist conservative Christian clearly can agree with that. Scripture says that God created them after their own kind. My problem with evolution has nothing to do with my Christian beliefs. It has to do with science. The science has not proven that macroevolution is true. See, this grand Darwinian synthesis that Philip Johnson was talking about represents a huge leap, or what we would call an extrapolation, beyond what the evidence shows, from the evidence of microevolution, which everyone believes, to what is called macroevolution. This is what confuses people that are not educated on evolution. They'll look at microevolution, and then they'll say, well, evolution is true. Well, this is not accurate. Microevolution has been proven. Every single person agrees with that. There's no problem with that. All that is God's creation. But macroevolution has not been proven. What is macroevolution? Well, that is to say that all life evolved from a primordial ancestor through only naturalistic mechanisms. So how can we be sure that macroevolution is true or false? And is there evidence for it? Ladies and gentlemen, the problem is that the fossil evidence stands starkly against macroevolution. Go check out creation.com for proof and evidence of this. Now, Darwin answered this problem by saying, well, maybe these transitional animals all existed in the past. And his thought was eventually they may be discovered. He wasn't sure about it. However, the fact today in the year 2011, where we have better science, more tools than Darwin had. Here's the sad fact for evolutionists. The sad fact for evolution is that paleontologists have unearthed a very good deal of fossil remains of extinct animals since Darwin even first published Origin of Species. And to the disappointment of evolutionists, ladies and gentlemen, these fossils have not been found. They have not found these transitional forms. Instead, what they have simply found are more distinct animals which have died off. Do you see the problem? See, if Darwinian evolution were true, there should be literally, listen, ladies and gentlemen, millions and millions and millions and millions of these transitional forms, these intermediates, but they are not found in the fossil records. For example, think for a moment. Think of all the intermediate forms that would have to exist in order for a bat and a whale to be descended from a common ancestor. Yet, ladies and gentlemen, we don't see Darwinian theory being correct. They are not there. They are nowhere. And a bat and a whale are both mammals, aren't they? And vertebrates? I mean, think of all the intermediate forms we should have. Where are they? If Darwinian evolution was true, we would see that. This is a major problem for the fictional Darwinian theory, and it is a major problem. It's time to be honest. Ladies and gentlemen, the year 2011, these transitional forms, these intermediates, will never be found because you know it as well as I do, they are not there. The evidence is totally against evolution. In their book, The Anthropic Cosmological Principle, John Barrow and Frank Tipler, two physicists, they list at least 10 steps. Listen to this. This is interesting. They list 10 steps in the course of human evolution, for example, like the development of aerobic respiration, development of photosynthesis, the development of your eye, the development of the inner skeleton, and so forth and so on. What they did is they listed 10 steps in the course of human evolution, each of which is so improbable that before it could occur, they say the sun would have already ceased to be a main sequence star and would have incinerated the Earth. Let me quote from this study, quote, "There has developed a general consensus among evolutionists that the evolution of intelligent life is so improbable that it is unlikely to have occurred on any other planet in the entire visible universe, end quote. Now, folks, if that is the result of the study, then why? Why think that it has evolved by chance on this planet? Let's just say it, folks. The truth is this. The only reason why someone would believe it is they're just uneducated on it. They haven't looked at it yet. And go to creation.com. You could educate yourself on that. Or they are educated on it, and they see that there's no proof and evidence for evolution, but they have a prior commitment to naturalism. So I believe that atheism and evolution can be crushed, and it is being crushed, where it is actively being confronted, and in societies where it's not being seriously confronted, we're seeing their societies unravel and begin to crumble. But I am very excited. I am seeing a lot of progress in this grassroots movement. For example, I just received another email from a subscriber who is extremely excited about the Question Evolution campaign. How excited is he? Well, he has decided to raise his own support and pursue the Question Evolution campaign ministry full time. I am also enthusiastic about the campaign, and I think what is needed is a Christian all-out creation versus evolution war. That's what's needed, folks. Nothing else will do. And the good news is that evolution is so weak, we just need an army of weakened and part-time warriors to get the job done. If you want to devote more time than that, that's great. But I don't think it is needed unless, of course, you feel called to do so. As Christians, we need to take evolution out. And the good news is Christians have crushed all kinds of false beliefs and lies before. When is the last time you met a follower of Zeus? When is the last time you met a follower of Gnosticism? Do we even know what Gnosticism is? Probably not. You know why? Because Christianity pulverized Gnosticism, just like it's going to do with this fictional, dishonest evolutionary belief worldview. It is time to take Darwinism and atheism out. Check out creation.com and join the movement. Now, let's go through these 15 questions. And after this, if you guys want to talk to me live, I'm going to be at www.shockonow.net in the chat room, and I'm going to be doing a little mini class on how to debate atheist evolutionists and win every single time. You know, I've challenged the thinking atheist to a debate. He's here on Blog Talk Radio, but he does not want to debate me. Wonder why? Could it be that the proof and evidence is on my side? The truth is on Christianity's side? I challenge the number one most subscribed to atheist on YouTube, the amazing atheist. He does not want to debate me either. Why is this, folks? If you want to hear me in debate with an atheist and an evolutionist, go to shockonow.net, www.shockonow.net, and click Music Podcast, and you could see why the atheist evolutionist are like timid little bunnies and they don't want to debate. Let's go through these 15 questions. Number one, how did life originate? See, we just talked about that, and scientists don't know. Well, some scientists do. They'll admit that God created. God was the originator. But if they're a naturalist, they have a predetermined worldview of naturalism, they don't really know. For example, evolutionist Professor Paul Davies, he admitted it. He said, quote, "Nobody knows how a mixture of lifeless chemicals just spontaneously organized themselves into the first living cell." Andrew Knoll, he's a professor of biology, Harvard, he said, quote, "We don't really know how life originated on this planet. Do you guys know that a minimal cell needs several hundred proteins? Even if every atom in the universe were an experiment with all the correct amino acids present for every possible molecular vibration in the supposed evolutionary age of the universe, not even one average-sized functional protein would form. So how did life with hundreds of proteins originate just by chemistry without intelligent design?" Even Francis Crick, the co-discoverer of DNA, says, he talks about it being a miracle. Number two of the 15 questions that evolutionists cannot answer, how did the DNA code originate? Remember, Francis Crick was the co-discoverer of DNA. And this code is a sophisticated language system with letters and words where the meaning of the words are unrelated to the chemical properties of the letters. Just as the information on the computer screen that you're looking at or pixels on a screen are not properties of it, what other coding system has existed without intelligent design? How did the DNA coding system arise without it being created? Folks, chat with me at www.shockonal.net. Go into the chat room. I'm going to be giving a little mini class on how to debate an atheist evolutionist and defeat them every single time. I'm going to be doing it right after the show. Mutations. How could mutations, which are all they are, is accidental copying mistakes, how could mutations create the huge volumes of information in the DNA of living things? How could such errors create 3 billion letters of DNA information to change a microbe into a human, a microbiologist? Question four. Oh, by the way, on mutations, here's another problem. How does a 32-component rotary motor like ATP synthase or robots like Kinesin, how did they originate? This is the evolution atheist chance of the gaps. They always use that chance of the gaps. I just don't have enough blind faith to be an atheist evolutionist, folks. Let's go to question four. Why is natural selection, a principle that is recognized by creationists, taught as evolution? It has nothing to do with it. They teach it as if it explains the origin of the diversity of life. Question five. How did new biochemical pathways, which involve multiple enzymes working together in sequence, originate? Evolutionary biochemist Franklin Harold wrote, quote, "We must concede that there are presently, listen folks, no detailed Darwinian accounts of the evolution of any biochemical or cellular system, only wishful speculations." Question six, living things look like they were designed. So how do evolutionists know that they were not designed? Or is this just their predetermined view where they're just going to be a naturalist? Listen what Richard Dawkins said. He said, Biology is the study of complicated things that have the appearance of having been designed with a purpose. That's what Richard Dawkins said. He admits that they have the appearance of being designed with a purpose. Remember Francis Crick, the co-discoverer of the double helix structure of DNA? He said, biologists must constantly keep in mind that what they see was not designed, but rather evolved. Can you see these biologists in the lab? It's not designed, trying to convince themselves of it. That's sad. Question seven. How did multicellular life originate? This is another problem for evolutionists. How did cells adapted to individual survival learn to cooperate and specialize to create complex plants and animals? Question eight. How did sex originate? Asexual reproduction gives up to twice as much reproductive success for the same resources as sexual reproduction. So how could the latter ever gain enough advantage to be selected? And then this one's a serious problem, question nine. Why are the expected countless of millions of transitional fossils missing? There is no proof and evidence that evolution is accurate and correct, folks. Look, Darwin noted the problem, and it still remains. These evolutionary family trees and textbooks, you guys, they're based on imagination, not evidence. Harvard paleontologist Stephen Jay Gould wrote, quote, "The extreme rarity," notice what he says, "the extreme rarity," not rarity, it's an extreme rarity of transitional forms in the fossil record persist as the trade secret of paleontology. And other evolutionist fossil experts also admit the problem. We're going to be going off the air in about 3 minutes. I'll see you guys at www.shockonow.net, shockawenow.net. That's shockawenow.net. Click chat, have your speakers on. I'll be there live. I'm going to be giving a class on how to debate an evolutionist and an atheist and win the debate every single time. Question 10. How do living fossils remain unchanged over supposed hundreds of millions of years if evolution has changed worms into humans in the same time frame? Question 11. How did blind chemistry create mind, intelligence, meaning, altruism, and morality? And question 12. And this one really drives me crazy. Why do evolutionists tell these just-so stories? Why is evolutionary just-so storytelling tolerated? What that means is they'll just say, oh, this is just the way it is, and they have no proof and evidence. Evolutionists use flexible storytelling to explain observations, but it's not based on proof and evidence. Question 13, where are the scientific breakthroughs due to evolution? There's none. Question 14, science involves experimenting to figure out how things work. Well, evolution fails the scientific method because you have to see how they operate. And why is evolution, it's really just a theory about history. Why is it taught as operational science, as if it's the same as operational science? And question 15, why is evolution, which is really a religious idea, why is a fundamentally religious idea a dogmatic belief system that fails to explain the evidence taught in science classes? Ladies and gentlemen, you have the right to be angry about your children being lied to about evolution. You know, I talked to a lot of folks at shockonow.net in the chat room, and we've even had atheists, agnostics, naturalists admit there is no proof and evidence that evolution is true. I'll see you guys at www.shockonow.net. I'm there right now. Also, don't forget to get your free chat room and free website at the top of the page. And please, if you care about truth, and you care about the world around you, go to www.creation.com. Look in the middle of the page. You'll see a slot there. Put your email address there, and we'll keep you up to date on how this awesome, wonderful, glorious grassroots movement for truth is going. God bless you guys. I love you. This is Shock, and have a great week.